Thank you for staying on top of that. All right, welcoming everyone in. Welcome, everyone. Hello. Good to see you. Welcome. Welcome, everyone. Awesome. Thank you, everyone. And I want to give a shout out to my colleagues, Simeon and Tara, who just turned me on to this Black Lives Matter Spotify playlist. It is awesome. Check it out. You'll probably be hearing more from that over the course of the next short little while. Well, great. We are going to get started. And I'd like to ask everyone to rename themselves. This will help in a moment be able to put people into breakout rooms. So if you could start your name with either P or S, whether you're a student, S, or a P for professional, then your first name and then your affiliation. Ramsey has it nailed. Ramsey, you know how we roll. And so if anyone is having trouble doing that, just drop a note in the chat window and my colleagues stand ready to assist. And people will be trickling in momentarily, but I think the key people are here to get started with our first segment. Welcome, everyone. You are here for the first Make It Until You Make It challenge of spring 2021. We are so excited to have you here kicking us off at the Bold Challenge. And I'm going to first and foremost, before we dive entirely into this program to talk about emotional intelligence and the ways in which design thinking can hone our emotional intelligence skills, we are going to give you a little entertainment. We have some mentors in the house from Verizon and some other organizations, but Verizon is a sponsor of our 2021 series. And so we have a number of great Verizon mentors here. And I'm going to turn the show over to Ramsey Moorman of Verizon, a longtime mentor here in our community. And he will be interviewing two job candidates, yours truly, and our colleague, Yomi Salu. And so Ramsey, take it away.
Excellent. Well, good afternoon, Humaira and Yomi. I appreciate your patience as we try to schedule these interviews. Listen, we've been really, really slammed and tight for time. So we're actually doubling up on interviews today. So this particular job is in Fios. It's a fast growing technology that is connecting homes and high speed internet, enabling the internet of things, et cetera. And it's a rapidly changing market, and the market actually drives what's important to not only our customers, but to us as well, Verizon. We really care what our customers think. And so the job requires candidates to be competent in talking about and understanding technology. And because you will be interacting with customers, we really need somebody with strong people skills, right? We need somebody that has the ability to observe what's happening in the marketplace from a consumer perspective, but also someone that can communicate with multiple teams and really work well with others. Ultimately, we need someone with strong soft skills. So Humaira, I'd like to start with you, if you don't mind. I'd like to start just by asking you, Humaira, why do you want this job?
Well, First of all, thank you, Ramsey. I'm really excited to about this position. I think this job was made for me. I am really good with people. I have so many friends. I mean, people just love me. But I'm really excited about Verizon. It's such a prestigious employer, and you have such a big footprint here in New York City, where I live, and I really want to be close to my folks. And you're an employer that pays really well. I can tell you, a lot of the companies that I've worked for, they just don't pay me what I feel I'm worth, and you compensate people really well. And even though this position is sort of a little bit junior to what I think I can do, I feel that I would do a really good job. And you have these other product management positions that I'm really excited about stepping into. So that's why I'd like the job.
Okay. Thank you for that. Yomi, how about you?
Oh, yes. Thank you very much, Ramsey. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to actually talk to you regarding this job. So for me, I think, in addition to all the other good things that Verizon does and Verizon offers, I think this actually just aligns very well with my passion and the purpose of helping further the broadband gap between, users, caregivers, and also patients. So one thing, one of my experience when I was in my freshman year, actually, I had an experience of actually going to one of the hospitals, and the emergency room was just full of people. So when I looked at how broadband or fiber or just availability to broadband would allow folks, at home not to have to come to the hospital, I think being able to leverage technology and further my passion in helping solving problems similar to what those folks were having challenges with, I think that's one reason why I want this job, being able to solve problems, help further Verizon's agenda, and being a social responsible company. I think I will fit well in that organization. And that's one of the reasons why I want this job.
Excellent. Thank you.
Okay, so we're going to pause from this interview for a moment. And now imagine there's a panel of ESPN sports commentators who are going to rip us apart. All right, so lead commentator is Christopher Clark of Verizon. He is joined by Marcus Taylor, also of Verizon, and two of my colleagues from Real Industry, Tara Romani and Simeon Cornegay. So what didn't work about that?
Well, friends, we saw two very different performances there. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Between Humera and Yumi there, you could see very early how Humera was just focusing on a lot of things that perhaps the interviewer wasn't really looking for. She focused on her friends, the compensation, the fact that the position wasn't something that she wanted. Yumi was really clear that, he understood what the recruiter wanted. He could tell that he appreciated his time. He understood that it was important that the business aligned with his passion around closing the broadband gap. He even shared a personal story. It was really amazing to see those two different performances. What do y'all think?
Yeah, I'll go first. Yeah, I definitely agree. I think you could tell in the beginning, just looking at the differences and the kind of emotional intelligence really comes out in the two different interviews, because there's kind of a clear divide on talking about themselves, like Humera kind of talked more about herself and her needs versus how those may be aligned with the company and what the company was looking for. And then, so there's definitely a difference there.
Yeah, I would add too, one seems more genuine, authentic, to the side that he was talking about his past and how it connects to Verizon. And then Humera's was talking more about like how she enjoys it and people love her and things like that. So it's more directed towards her, like Tara said, versus the job and the company itself.
Yeah, one thing I wanted to highlight is, Humera wasn't offensive or anything like that. She was very likable, right? So when you look at that in silos and she was complimenting Verizon as the company, you can kind of get lost into, oh, that wasn't necessarily bad, right? But then when Yomi goes and he talks about the passion and he's telling you a story and he's bringing you in, as a leader, I'm now intrigued on not only is this something that Yomi wants to do, but I'm going to get the most out of him because he's explaining what it means to him, right? And how it directly impacts his own experience. And so, you know, sometimes non-emotional intelligent interviews are not necessarily negative, right? Because Humera wasn't offensive or mean, but she didn't really bring me in like Yomi did.
Yeah, and I would echo, I know when I am interviewing people and hiring for my teams, you have to factor in that the personality, right? So you're ultimately gonna work with somebody for more time than you usually spend with family during the week. Like you're with somebody for 40 plus hours a week. So do I wanna spend that much time with somebody becomes a factor that's, you know, it is contributed to the decision-making. So again, to Ramsey's point, like Humera didn't say anything that was off-putting, but you know, the way Yomi kind of told this story, they both told stories, but his was personally connected to what the, you know, the purpose of Verizon is. And he was telling it in a way that it was passion. Like you can, I can teach both Humera and Yomi how to do the job technically, but I can't teach them the passion behind it, right? So knowing that he was that passionate about helping people and having, you know, changing the impact of hospital rooms, like that's something that I can't teach. And I bring him onto my team and I know that I can teach him how to do the X's and O's and he'll use his passion to take it that much further.
Awesome. Okay, so shall we fast forward to question two?
Back to the interview.
Yeah.
All right, Humera, listen, thank you for, again, giving me your thoughts. And it sounds like you sort of understand the industry. But can you share an experience, perhaps, of being on a team that didn't work well? What happened?
Oh, Ramsey, I can tell you, in my my senior year for computer science, we had this telecommunications project and I was working on a team and, you know, we were tasked with identifying a means by which we could provide telemedicine to underserved parts of the United States, like Appalachia and various other places. And I can tell you that, you know, my team just, you know, they did not get the issues of people living in poverty. And I just, they could not relate. I could not connect with them. And it was a very difficult semester. If they had only adopted my idea, I mean, my idea was the best idea. You know, one of my teachers even told me so, that it was a genius idea. And I just had a really hard time getting across this team. I commanded them to learn about these individuals who, you know, who just use technology in a different way. And my team just, they did not. They never made it to meetings. It was a disaster. I think I got the worst grade of my entire 4 years in that class. I think what I learned was that I work better solo.
Interesting. Okay. Thank you for sharing. I appreciate that. Yomi, how about you? Same question. Working with a team that maybe didn't go so well. What happened?
Yeah, it was a tough one, but you know, the situation was very similar. I think that the only difference that I had here was I try to look at things from a different standpoint, right? Obviously, when I think a project should be run a certain way and it was not run that way, the normal instinct was to, hey, look, this is how we should do it. Here's what I've got. I got grades on similar projects and, you know, I got a 98. So why don't you guys just listen to me? But I think I just try to tap into others' point of view and see how to utilize their expertise. And so we could all work together. It was very strong opinions. A lot of people had very strong opinions, which at some point clashed, but everyone had a very valid point. So we just had to listen. I think I even learned a lot of what not to do in some cases, because we were all under stress. So I was able to take some good lessons out of that. We made some progress because we started listening to each other more, we started collaborating more, and we started working more as a team, because we saw that if we didn't do that, then obviously we were all gonna fail, because all of the grades were dependent on everyone being participating. Everyone needed to be giving their point of view, and we will either go all win together or lose together. So even though it was one of the most stressful time of my college experience, I would not trade it in for anything, because I did get some things that will help me even in this job that I'm applying for. So just being able to to progress inspired despite the situation or what kind of pressure or folks that you're working with. So I was able to get some kind of experience from that.
Thank you.
Well, once again, two extremely contrasting performances there from Humaira and Yomi. Humaira, both very stressful situations, but dealt with in very different ways. Humaira, kind of quickly jumped to blaming the team. There was so much focus on her ideas and, a little bit of sort of possessiveness about where the opportunity lie coming from her mind. And then, also focusing on the team shortcomings and just really kind of showing a lack of, ability and commitment to working in collaboration, being part of a team. Whereas Yomi very quickly focused on empathy. You could hear it in how he wanted to, make space for other people's opinions. He also mentioned the market context, so it sort of framed the situation, helped us understand a bit better. And then ultimately, Yomi took it as a learning opportunity, choosing to focus instead on improving the team's listening ability so that they could be better working together going forward. What does everybody else think?
I can jump in. So just listening to the two different ones, when Humaira was talking, it was kind of easier for me to zone out because she was kind of just complaining and then hyping herself up over I don't even know what. But then when Yomi was talking, he like listed all the things that, made it difficult, but then reflected back on it, was like, but in the end game and the big picture, like it was still worth it, or I learned XYZ. So I think that just shows like the huge difference in emotional intelligence. When you're faced with like a problem or situation, how are you gonna look at it? And that was the biggest thing I saw.
Yeah, there were a couple buzzwords that I wanted to highlight. When Humaira went, she used they a lot. Commanded was up there. I was told, in terms of the best idea, there was a lot of center focus, right? And, both of them articulated that they had the experience that others should follow in terms of having the best idea, or Yomi saying he got a 98, right? So both had the status quo, if you will, to take command. But what Yomi's approach was he used we, our failure, it's not a good look. He used the word experience. And ultimately he saw the long game. And ultimately, even if he wasn't gonna get that 98, the growth of the team was something that he wanted to see and that he was proud to share. So leaving that experience of not necessarily getting a 98 or having the best performance, having that experience, then preparing him that he mentioned for this job allows me as a leader to understand that Yomi is gonna go through some challenging times just being new to the job, but how does he respond to that, right? And what's his attitude around understanding that it's an experience and that he can kind of grow, and more importantly, lean on others to help him grow, which is specifically what I said in the beginning of the meeting, which means he was paying attention.
Yeah. Exactly. And I think one other thing that was called out was Humera ended it saying, in the future, I'm just going to do this solo, right? Yeah. And that kind of shows you the approach. So when you face adversity, like these two employees that you're looking for, Ramsey, like, you know, one is going to get frustrated and go at it by themselves, and the other one is going to try to find another way to work together with the team.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I was going to say that the major flaw I found from Humera's answer was that I didn't quite get the right context in which, like, what was the project, what was the objective, because there were ways that she could have as well told us that she was not at fault for the failure. But by providing that context and saying, okay, this was the problem we're trying to solve, this was my original idea, but for some reason, the team did not adopt my idea and it ended up how it did. So the major learning point then would have been that she had learned how to get buy-in, right? She had learned how to communicate her ideas better. She's learned how to get people to adopt or work with her ideas. And in that way, we as ourselves would be the judge on whether her idea was the best or not, not her throwing it at us as my idea was the best, everyone else's idea was crap.
And I think the issue here is that it almost doesn't even matter what the context is. What matters is my attitude. What matters is the way in which I approached that that challenge. And that's one thing I would suggest is that, you know, if I'm going to bring this attitude to that project, I'm going to bring it to every project. I'm going to bring it to all of my employers' projects. Great.
Excellent. Well, let's fast forward to the end of the interview.
Thank you both for your time today. I know, you know, it's kind of unorthodox to have two interviews at the same time, but listen, I really appreciate it. That's really all I have on my end. I wanted to save a little bit of time to answer any questions that you may have. So do you have any questions to us about FIOS or what it's like to work here? Humera, we'll start with you.
I really don't have any questions. I feel like I have a lot of experience in FIOS and know a lot about Verizon. So no, I don't think there's anything you can answer for me. You know, actually, I really value my workout schedule. And so like, I'm wondering if like, you know, what the culture is like, can I like leave at 5 to go like hit the gym and like get home in time? You know, what's the norm?
Yeah, I mean, you know, depending on the workload, it's a question I haven't been approached with. You know, it's something that we can talk about based on your schedule and your needs. But ultimately, we have a job to do and to accomplish. And so ultimately, if you're leaving when that job is not done, probably not a good look, but it's something that we can talk about should you be offered the position.
Great. Thank you, Ramsey. Of course, I'll be offered the position. I'm like, I'm great.
Yomi, what do you have to say about that? Any questions, my friend?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Brian, for your time again. Yes, so you I have a few questions here, but you already answered a few of them during the course of the interview, so thank you for that. But I did have three more questions. The first one was, what are some of the trends that you see in FIOS that excite you and that basically just, you know, fires you up every morning when you come to work?
Yeah, you know, one of the things I love about FIOS, and we talked about it earlier, is just the connectivity and bringing content that's meaningful to those that need it, whether it's, you know, via video or more importantly, internet connection. COVID-19 has struck America's heart, right? And so connectivity is a necessity, almost like water, when you're talking about education and things of the like. So I enjoy the fact that literally toddlers and young kids are being exposed to laptops and tablets quicker than they ever had been before because they're leaning on this connectivity. And who better of a partner to help them navigate through STEM activities than Verizon by providing that connectivity. So just seeing the need for what we offer is really breathtaking and exciting.
Wow, thank you very much. And my next question was, I know about a year ago, I watched Verizon's CEO talk about social injustice and what Verizon was doing for, you know, COVID for the employees. How does that make you feel as an employee? And I know Verizon does a lot for their employees. How does that make you feel? And how does that even fulfill you more? Or what does it do for you as an employee?
You know, Hans Vestberg, our CEO, when he came in 2019, completely reshaped the focus of our company. And he really focused on four key pillars. You know, our shareholders, right? We are a for-profit company. Our customers, obviously, are the ones that we do business with. But two equally important pillars were society, how are we impacting society and our employees? And to see that visualization for him to break up the company in terms of priority, 25% in equal parts, was very meaningful. But it wasn't just wordplay. He set up very, very important conversations. He addressed the company publicly. He set up every single day around noon to address things that were going on in the nation. He set up opportunities that HR driven for courageous conversations and instilled that capability through playlists of how to have those conversations at the core, at the front line. And so knowing that we have a company with a CEO providing this vision and the company supporting that, and to address things like social and injustice and things that alike, is very rewarding because it allows us to be ourselves authentically and not be, you know, just this face and faking who we are when we're essentially experiencing trauma and what's going on in society. So I think it's a great opportunity for us to navigate through.
Thank you very much. And my last question. So which all of these things that Verizon is doing, which one of this social responsibility aspect is your favorite and which one aligns with you the most?
Yeah, I think just literally being able to have conversations at work about what's going on in society in a safe environment is very impactful. I think it allows us to build our brand and our culture where we can have difficult conversations and learn from each other, not only, you know, during the business, but what I learned from just my other colleagues of multiple different cultures and races has allowed me to be a better father, right? A better husband, because now I'm able to teach and have those conversations at home. I actually spoke to a gentleman who, white gentleman, who remembers vividly that his mother said, "You can't go to the beach because it's a black beach." Now I'm too young to have experienced that, right? But him being able to share that experience vividly in his mind allows me to grow and understand what it's like for him to understand what's going on. And just to have that camaraderie as a V-teamer is great. And so I think just having that authentic conversation in a safe environment at work allows me to come to work happier and enjoy the company outside of just collecting a paycheck.
Great, thank you very much. And that's all the questions I have. If I have any, as the time goes on, I will shoot you an email. Thank you very much.
Very nice to spend time with you both.
Thank you. All right, Christopher.
Wow, well, you know, I don't think there could have been more different endings to those interviews. One, you know, was a deep experience and the other was really just a massive missed opportunity, not only to learn more about the company and, you know, how it fits into broader culture, but also to make an impression, obviously. Mara had basically no questions. She showed that she wasn't interested. She felt like she already knew everything. And then to even go from there to show that lack of interest to talk about her competing interests outside of work was just, you know, very not going to work in her favor, not going to service her. And then on the other hand, you had Yomi, you know, who showed his appreciation once again, started with appreciation, finished with appreciation for the time. Showed his preparation by having questions ready, the number of questions, acknowledging that some of them had already been answered, and then showed his interest in learning again, just reiterated that growth mindset, that appetite for learning. First asking about, you know, how files fit into the tech sphere, then, you know, showing his curiosity about how Verizon was committed to both culture and society, and then also trying to gain some personal insight from Ramsey, you know, asking about how he personally felt like he fit into the company. So Tara, what did you see?
Well, I totally agree with you. There couldn't have been two more polar opposite interviews. I definitely think again, you can see like the emotional intelligence, just because at the end of the interview, instead of being more inquisitive, Humera was kind of like, well, the interview's done, cat's in the bag. Like, that was my last checkbox, so we're good now. Versus Yomi, who was like, hey, I'm still gonna ask all these questions. I'm not gonna assume anything. I'm going to, you know, give thanks. So I think it was just two very different dynamics. One is assuming and one is more like grateful.
What I like about Yomi's question too is I think sometimes it gets lost on people who are applying for jobs that these companies are lucky to have you too. Like you going to Verizon, you know, like we're a great company and, you know, you're lucky to be in a company that supports you in that way, but it's not just a one-way road. Like always keep in mind and remember that you're talented and you're valuable too. So the company is lucky to have you considering them to join and take your talents and what you do and what you bring here. We would be very lucky to have you join us too. And both Humera and Yomi, like the way they approach it, what they bring to the table, we would be lucky to have that. So you want to obviously be humble with it at all times, just have Kendrick playing in your mind when you're in those situations. But like, just remember that there's that value too. It's not just a one-way road. Like you guys, you know, we're lucky to have you too. And him asking what's the right fit from a culture standpoint from Ramsey and getting his take on it is a good way to get that temperature check to make sure that this is the right place that I want to lend my talent to and I want to give help this company grow as well.
You know, Marcus hit it right on the head. Like as I'm in role and I'm thinking through this conversation emotionally, I was defensive with Humera. I was like, oh, you got this on the bag. And I'm thinking in my mind, like, what do you not have checked in the box, right? I just emotionally was like, no, I'm gonna find something that humbles you. Whereas Yomi, to Marcus's point, I felt like I was selling him. I felt like he put me on the spot to say, no, this is why you wanna come to Verizon. This is why Verizon is great. And then for him to put then me on the spot and say, what's Ramsey, what's your favorite point? Now he's almost interviewing me and I'm kind of justifying why I'm talking great about Verizon. And so emotionally, he put me on a spot where now I'm intrigued. And, you know, I was kind of trying to think about, okay, why am I here? Right. And so it was a very interesting dialogue and an unintentional emotional catch while I was in role.
Any final thoughts from the commentators before I step out of role? Well, that was very uncomfortable for me. Well, I mean, not so much. I mean, I like playing, I like improvisation, and I don't mind being self-effacing. But what was really hard about that was being arrogant and taking a knowing stance as though I have all the answers and you expect me to have the answers and you should just take that as a given. It's so important to be humble, to approach it from a point of humility. And take a learning stance. Every interaction is a learning opportunity. Every human has something to share. And that's a key part of emotional intelligence. No matter whether you agree or disagree, like or dislike, have something in common with or don't, to be able to find that common ground is really a key part of emotional intelligence. And being able to relate in that way to your interviewer is super important. But even beyond the interview, even, you know, after you get the job and you're interacting with anyone in a workplace setting or even in your local community. So I want to end this segment by thanking the my fellow actors, Ramsey, the interviewer, and Yomi, the fellow candidate. Yomi, I would hire you in a heartbeat. You are amazing.
Thank you very much.
And, I hired you, by the way, so we're good.
And the commentators, Christopher, thank you for leading, and Marcus and Tara and Simeon and all of you who provided insights, thank you so much. I'm going to take this to the next level and share my screen and close out this section by sharing some key highlights about emotional intelligence. Hang on. All right. And can you all see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, terrific. So EQ skills. There's a lot of great writing about emotional intelligence. I highly recommend that you check out Emotional Intelligence 2.0. It's an excellent book written by Travis Bradbury and Jean Greaves. And these are some highlights that come from one of the seminal writers, Dan Goleman. He's a psychologist. And so emotional intelligence can be described in broadly in two key areas. One is your personal competence, how you handle yourself, your own self-awareness, knowing what's going on with your emotions, your self-confidence, and your triggers, what affects that. Self-regulating, being able to check in with yourself and then be able to do something about it, being able to reset and be conscientious about your emotions, and your motivation, how you are able to harness your goals and your drive to be to get something done, to be productive and to achieve. And then on the alternate side, there's social competence, how you handle relationships with others. First and foremost is empathy, right? Being able to walk in the shoes of others, perspective taking. How do others walk through life? What may their experiences have been to lead them to a certain point of view? And really being curious about other people in that sense. And social skills, being able to clearly communicate, persuade, influence, find common ground, build bonds. All of those things are so important. And it is clearly well researched that those who are in leadership positions also have score very high on the EQ test. So those folks who are really good in these different categories are the ones who rapidly ascend through the ranks because they are able to manage themselves really well and interact with others really well. So no matter how technically competent you are, how skilled you are, employers are really looking for this. Now, we're going to turn next to design and talk about design and design thinking. But first, we're going to start with the story of a designer. And I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Marcus, to introduce us to a designer.
Great. Thanks, Humaira. So joining us today and speaking about design and a little bit about BOLD, so what BOLD stands for, this being the BOLD Challenge, is Malcolm Jones. He's with Verizon Media as well. He's a product manager by day, and he can go into that. But what he does on the side is also design work, and he's talented enough that he's actually had one of his designs make its way onto a t-shirt and being sold in Verizon across all the companies. So let him be humble about it, but let me brag about him for it. So he's got the side hustle down. But introducing you to Malcolm, and he'll tell you a little bit about BOLD, which is our employee resource group, and a little bit about design as well. Malcolm?
Yeah, I'm glad you said that because I hate talking about myself. thanks for having me here. My name is Malcolm Jones. I am a product manager on the Verizon Media side. I'm actually working to start a new organization here called Product Inclusion, where we look across all of our consumer products, so like Yahoo Stores, Yahoo Finance, look to see if they are inclusive products, if they are excluding any group of people. So just getting that started, I'm excited about that. I just moved into that space. As Marcus said, I lead or help to lead our BOLD ERG, which is our Black Employee Resource Group at Verizon Media. We kind of have a two-pronged mission. Half of it is internally facing. So we want to make Verizon Media a great place for our Black employees to work. So we hold events, we act as a resource when it comes to learning about promotion, getting promotions and just navigating career type stuff. And then on the external front, we like to also push Verizon. Ramsey mentioned like Verizon is doing a lot of stuff in the social justice space, and we've realized that and we love it, but we want to keep pushing Verizon to do more. So that's kind of what Bold is. It's great. Have tons of fun doing it. So a little bit about my designer story. I wouldn't call myself a design person or a designer. I am in product. I'm an engineer at heart. I went to school for computer science, but I like to draw and do that kind of on the side. But as Marcus said, one of the things that I got to do last year was do a design for the company. And it was kind of like a passion project when all of the protests were going on last summer. It really hit home just doing all of the internal work, trying to lead the Bold organization during that. Just one night I was sitting at home and I just doodled this Black Power Fist. And it was just comprised of names of Black people who had been killed over the past 10 years by police. And so I did that, and that was, I just kind of did it and put it to the side. And then a couple of days later, I was approached by someone internally asking, did I want to, I also posted on my social media. I was then approached by someone internally asking, did I want to work with our marketing team, and Chris was involved in this as well, to create a product where we could raise money for social justice causes. And so I was able to kind of take that original idea and meld it into something new, still incorporated Black Power Fist and make a t-shirt, and was able to sell that. And we did a good job of raising money you have a pop-up here for a computer update. And so I just say that to say sometimes my art and design just rolls from a passion perspective. And that's what most of my artwork is and design work is. And then I have another side of me where I actually do stuff for folks. Oh gosh. Sorry, my computer's trying to update. Where I work with folks to like do design for logos and whatnot. And when those types of projects come along, they're definitely way more collaborative. I'm not just going off and doing something on my own. I love to collaborate in everything I do as part of my role as a product manager, but also when it comes to design. So in those instances, I'll try to see what kind of idea the person has. And from there, I'll work out examples and get some inspiration from other works and bring that in and get some thoughts from the person I'm doing work for. And we kind of build the final design together. A recent example is my stepdad owns a hot sauce company and he needed a new logo. And so I kind of looked through, you want a classic logo? Do you want a modern logo? And we just pulled a whole bunch of designs from the internet and used it as like a whiteboard to pull from. And we came out with something that was really nice. And that's kind of my process. So it's either a passion project where I'll just go off and do something that comes from my heart, or I'll collaborate with the person who's asked me to do something. That's kind of where I am in design from an art perspective. And then my role as a product manager, it's about designing products that people can use, that everyone can use, products that can meet people where they are. So whether you have a disability or just are in a different socioeconomic status from someone else, just my products, I want them to work for you. So it's kind of my story as a designer.
Great. Thank you so much, Malcolm, for sharing your story. Appreciate it. It sounds to me like you're a full-fledged designer. That's a designer story. What I'd love to point out to students is that the field of design goes way back. And many of us think of design as a field that is pretty exclusive. You're designing high-end products, buildings, and there's a lot of art and creative that goes into that. And while that is true, there is also an emerging field and way of thinking called design thinking. And it has its roots in design, because what people observed was that the way designers think, take in information, narrow in on a certain area, imagine some possibilities, and then bring some of those possibilities to life, that very rough arc has profound utility in all areas, whether you're leading a team, designing a new service, working in your community. Some of you may have heard of design thinking, but it is a rapidly emerging area that universities and companies are exposing their students and employees to. So we're gonna turn next to a design thinker's story. And we're gonna have Chris from Verizon, Christopher Walker. Christopher Clark. I don't know why I've been calling you Christopher Walker for the last 24 hours. I'm so sorry about that. We're going to have Christopher take us through design thinking in his world.
Yeah, thanks, Humaira. Appreciate that. Christopher Walker. Maybe I should be Christopher Walker. I think it's a sign. Yeah, but I love design thinking. I love design. And a big part of it is what you just acknowledged, which is how broadly it can be applied. Like Malcolm, my sort of origin story was very much, you know, pencil and paper drawing. My dad was an illustrator, so I came through the door of visual design and animation. But I quickly learned that design could be applied way more broadly because it's basically boils down to the scientific method. We start out by defining the problem that we have given our goal or our topic. We spend a lot of time crafting challenge statements. Design is very much iterative, so we do that a lot. And then you go to ideating, prototyping, and testing to learn, and the process folds back on itself. And you can apply that to anything. You can apply it to a business, as Humaira acknowledged. You can apply it to a business strategy. You can apply it to building a product, a campaign. You can apply it to building your career, you know, or designing a service. It can really be applied to almost anything. So one quick example, a recent example of how we applied design thinking to a project was actually this month in February, we had a Black History Month effort that came up. And, you know, the general goal obviously is to celebrate Black history and culture, but the way that we had initially, the solution we had arrived at wasn't really going to cut it because of resources mainly. That was the reason I was given, is that we didn't have enough ability to quickly scale up an experience to celebrate Black history and culture in a way that it needed to, because we just didn't have, you know, people around. So we had to sort of hit pause and say, look, let's go back to the original intention and make sure that we're doing this in the right way. So we knew that, you know, the fundamental intention behind Black history is to prevent the erosion of a people and culture, a lot like what had happened to Native Americans, right? So with that knowledge, we wanted to, you know, focus in on the insight. The insight for us was that the fact is, when you talk about preserving a history and a culture and creating change, really, who controls the narrative, those people that are able to tell the story, is super, super important. That was the thing that we chose to focus on. It's not just about having stories told about you, but about you also being able to tell the stories. So with that, and, you know, that challenge statement in mind, we're able to reframe what the solution might be and ultimately arrived at our campaign, which was around making space for Black voices, just like Malcolm shared in his example, right? So we did a logo flip. We worked with a Pittsburgh artist named Janelle Young to do, you know, her version, her take on our Yahoo logo, and in the process tell a story of, you know, what resonated for her and how she brought herself to the project. We did a bunch of articles and spotlights on individual designers, and then also produced a bit more of a perspective and a point of view, an editorial framework for everybody else to work off of when they're curating stories around sports, news, finance, and so forth. So that's just one real immediate example of how we applied design thinking to really make sure that we were solving for the right problem, and then we could make sure that we came up with the solution that was actually going to meet the people's needs, the people that we serve.
That's excellent. Solving for the right problem is really essential. And building off that, I'm going to share my screen again. And let's present. So how do you know what the right problem is? Well, we're going to get to that in a minute. So we believe that you can enhance your emotional intelligence and become an even more high IQ person, EQ person, by honing your design thinking skills. Knowing what the right problem is really essential. And really, design thinking can be boiled down to a series of focus and flare opportunities. Flaring to understand and open your mind to what the problem is, narrowing in on a specific part of the problem perhaps, and then imagining lots of possible solutions through ideation, and then narrowing in on trying one of those possible ideas and focusing in on one. And this is a very simple graphic that can get more and more complex and is shown in different ways throughout this presentation, but I'll give you an example. My day job is at Stanford. My side hustle is with real industry. And at Stanford, we have this student team that went out to Nepal. Doctors there said we have a really big problem with preterm babies, babies born prematurely. And these students traveled all the way to Nepal, went to the hospital, went to these incubators. And what they found was that the incubators were empty. They were fully functional, probably a little bit too expensive and hard to maintain, but nevertheless, fully functional and empty. They realized that the problem was probably something else. What was that problem? So they went out into the rural parts of Nepal and they started interviewing mothers who had given birth prematurely. And what they discovered was that it wasn't the incubators or anything the hospital was doing, it was the journey from the rural villages to the hospitals where infants were dying due to the severe cold and stress of that journey. And so the students very quickly used commonly available materials to prototype what an infant warming device, this is a sleeping bag they used to quickly sew and demonstrate what could potentially solve that problem. They were able to put it in the hands of mothers and other practitioners, people who were taking these folks on that journey to say, hey, could something like this work? Now, fast forward several years later, this is the Embrace product. It's been sold to millions. This is the little insert here is a paraffin wax. You can heat up in water and then keep the baby warm during that journey. The reframe was critical. And as Christopher was saying, knowing what problem you're solving is really essential. So it's been said that Einstein was quoted as saying that if I had an hour, I'd spend 50 minutes on the problem, understanding the problem, and 10 minutes on designing the solution. And that is so true. It is really falling in love with the problem and staying in the problem space to understand whether you're truly solving the right problem is key. And when you practice your design thinking mindset, you're practicing and exercising certain design muscles, chief of which is practicing ambiguity. We live in very ambiguous times. Who would have known that a year ago we would be in a pandemic for a year, that we would have this urgency in redesigning education, in having laptops in every child's hands, in having homes connected all over the US at much faster pace, at vaccine distribution and cold storage. Just think at how quickly our problems are coming at us. We need you students to be quick on your feet. Companies need employees who can understand and live in ambiguity and be okay with that. Ambiguity is uncomfortable, inherently uncomfortable, but it is also a fact of life. So how might we hone our muscles and be able to practice ambiguity and embrace that unknown? So again, design thinking is a series of diverging and converging, flaring and focusing. And we're going to practice that together as a group. And we're gonna actually do that in some teams. We do believe strongly in learning by doing. So your challenge for the rest of today and this week is to how might we help college students become aware of their own emotional intelligence, become aware of the concepts of high EQ individuals. And we are going to do that by getting started in teams and having you get to know one another in teams. So I'm going to escape from this and stop sharing. I already have some breakout rooms all set to go. And I'm going to send students to breakout rooms in pairs. I'm going to hang on to the mentors. Students, you're going to get time with those mentors in just a moment. But when I send you to your team to meet your partner, I would like you to introduce yourselves. Who are you? what school do you go to, what year are you in, what major are you majoring in? And then I'd like you to share a highlight from the last year, something that has been unexpected and kind of special, and a low light. You can do it in the opposite order if you wish, but I think actually I would prefer you to do a highlight first and then a low light, something that you really struggled with this last year. It might be deeply personal. We encourage you to dig deep and be vulnerable. This is a community of people who care about one another's progress and care about one another. So, and we prize ourselves on really creating a safe space. So we're gonna send you off and give you 6 minutes to do this. So, no, not 6 minutes, 7 minutes to do this. And I am opening up the breakout rooms right now. And I'll give you a 2 minute warning. Oh, hold on 1 second. Maria, I think Yara, you might have stepped out for a minute. You might have lost your connection. I'm assigning you to a room. Great. Okay, see you back in 7 minutes. All right. Mentors, thank you so much for being here. We are going to need your help in first of all, thank you. That was amazing, the first half of this session. I hope that you felt it went really well too. Definitely was funny. Yomi, you're a natural at this. It's no wonder you have the job.
Yeah, it was very natural for me, and I feel bad for you. I was like, oh my God, you have to be very skilled to say some of the things that you said in an interview. So yeah, you're very skilled. It was natural for me because I'm like, oh, look, I've interviewed with Ramsey before and actually do some interview myself. So there you go.
Yeah, I realized there was a risk there in starting off looking like such a jerk, but you know, I think that's part of being humble is being to be a jerk. Ramsey, how was that for you?
It was fun. I'm all about EQ and just seeing the different approaches and the intentionality behind it, and just trying to be natural. And you know, I know Yomi for years, so it was kind of fun re-interviewing him in his environment. And he didn't change anything. He's naturally EQ, so it was fun.
That's great. And Christopher, you were an awesome commentator.
You know, I wasn't sure how much you wanted us to get into some sort of character when you mentioned like sportscasters. I was like, oh wow, I'm gonna channel my inner like sports pundit. I almost went a little overboard there, but yeah, it was fun to break it down in that way. And I just love role storming as a tactic, you know, to learn more about things. And it was way more engaging. I'm taking notes from you, Humera, on how to just construct this kind of learning experience, because seeing some people play down a scenario was way more engaging than going through the typical, you know, introductions or just talking at people. So I appreciated that.
Awesome. I'm glad. So for this next segment, I really appreciate the role that you all will play. What I'm going to ask students to do is interview you all about your own career journeys. And when you started realizing the importance of emotional intelligence, the different team interactions you had in your own college years, your early career days, when the light bulb went off for you. I mean, you're very high IQ people, of course. And I hope that you didn't all acquire this like doing Boy Scouts at the age of like 10 or something. Hopefully you have stories of like the light bulb going off. But what I'd like students to be able to do is pinpoint some opportunities during your own personal growth and development that allow them to design things that they could have provided as an intervention. Perhaps it's something your senior your guidance counselor at school, at K-12 school might have been able to share with you. Perhaps it's something that orientation at your first job may have been able to share with you. Maybe it's a public service video. Who knows what kinds of ideas the students might come up with, but we're gonna train them later to imagine lots of possible ways. And so
it's 4 o'clock.
Also sort of like a double benefit of them getting a chance to see your career trajectory and to really learn from your own personal experience, what you wish you would have known when you were in their shoes. And as well as doing double duty as providing inspiration for some interventions they can design. Do you have any questions for me at this juncture?
No, just a reminder, Humira, that I got a hard step at 4:30, if that's okay.
Yes, of course, that is okay.
Cool.
We have 3 teams of 2. I think Malcolm, while his photo is there, he might not be there, or maybe he is.
I'm here. I have to actually hop for now. I just want to stay on and say thank you all for having me.
Oh, Malcolm, it was such a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, Malcolm.
I think this is great. Y'all take care.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well.
So, Ramsey, totally okay that you have to hop off. As you know, we like to keep our events to 1 hour. We figured this special 2 hour would be needed for this design thinking activity. We will have one of our team members sub in for you and have them take over for the part that they may have presented to you, their idea. And we hope that you'll be able to attend on Friday, because the Friday session is when they will work on their prototypes further and come back with something to share.
Got it. Okay. Is that 3?
That's right, 3 Eastern. And my team is going to add you to the calendar invite.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, I'm going to just send a note to the participants. So I gave them the 1 minute mark. This is like a speed design thinking round. One hour is probably the minimum that I've ever seen. We're going to be keeping up the pace. Okay. All right, they're coming back in 30 seconds. All right, welcome back. How was that? Yeah, great. So what I wanted to share with you briefly is that a key part of working in teams, there's been some extensive research done on some of the factors of the most successful teams. There's a research study that came out of Harvard by Amy Edmondson, and there's also a good deal of work that the Google Corporation has done with its employees, a huge study of the most successful teams at Google compared to all other teams. And what they discovered was the single most important factor to team success is psychological safety. When a team feels that they can trust one another, they're able to share things with one another, that they're in the safety of one another, they can really rock. And it beats out all other factors, like being co-located with one another, getting paid enough, having the right technical skills, beats out all of those things is psychological safety. And so really establishing a psychological safety with your team member is important. If we had more time, I would have put you through a nice longer version of this, but I hope that by sharing something, a highlight and a low light, that you are able to connect with your teammate and start that good team relationship. Okay, next. Next, we're going to, let's share my screen. We are going to start with empathy. With design thinking, all things start with empathy and a real understanding of the person who might have faced that, might be facing a problem or a challenge. As with the students who traveled to Nepal, it was the mothers giving birth and perhaps the people assisting on that journey. In this instance, as you're designing for someone who would want to learn about emotional intelligence, you will be interviewing the Verizon mentors. Each of you will be assigned one person, and they're going to share with you their journey from the time that they may have gone through college to their early career to where they are now. And it should be a special treat for you to hear about that journey and to hear about when they realized about the importance of emotional intelligence, how they began to hone their emotional quotient. And what I'd like you to do, students, is take rigorous notes. Okay, you want to jot down every interesting thing that you hear about key parts of their about their history, projects they undertook, teachers that may have interfaced with them, and identify some key parts of their story that are ripe for having had some kind of learning experience, something that made them more aware of emotional intelligence earlier, right? That's the ideal, is that a lot of us don't realize about emotional intelligence until we're way into our careers, if even at all. And so by learning about the journeys of our mentors, we can pinpoint certain key areas that would have been ripe for you to have designed some intervention that would have made them more aware of emotional intelligence and the importance of it. So I'm going to assign each of the teams a mentor and give you an opportunity to interview them. All right, give me just one second. Okay. And I'm going to give you all 7 minutes to do this portion as well. And I'll give you a 1 minute reminder. So keep an eye on time. Remember, rigorous notes and off you go. Okay, welcome back, everyone. We hope that was fun. I'm going to continue on at a steady pace. And let's see. Okay. So we had you starting with empathy. And when you head back into your breakout sessions, you are going to, as a team, as a student team, pinpoint a specific problem or opportunity. You're not going to overthink it. If you had more time, you would spend some time debating and voting. But for the purpose of moving forward, you're just going to pick one specific time, point in time in your mentor's history that would have been perfect for an intervention to learn about EQ and become more conscientiously aware of it. But for now, we are going to engage in a little activity designed called Yes But, Yes And. And so I'm going to stop sharing my screen and I'm going to ask Tara and Simeon and Angelica to participate alongside me. We are planning a birthday party. We're planning a birthday party for my friend Christopher Clark at Verizon. He doesn't know it, he's turning 21. But we are going to be planning a party for him. And it's going to be awesome. And we're going to generate some ideas. Tara, Simeon, Angelica, take yourselves off mute. We're going to be generating some ideas for that party. And if I could ask for a volunteer, one of the students, all the students, to enter into the chat window the ideas that you hear, regardless of what the discussion we have. So Angelica's job is to start every sentence with yes, but. And Tara and I and Simeon are going to generate as many ideas as possible. So for Christopher's birthday, I think that, you know, given that it's socially distant, I think we should have a parade down Madison Avenue, surprise him. Someone brings him out there and all of a sudden there's like this huge parade.
Yeah, but that's expensive.
Yeah, but we could totally, and we could totally raise funds for it too. I'm sure people would love to pitch in for his birthday.
Yeah.
Yeah, so what if a parade doesn't work? How about we have everyone in the neighborhood, you know, open their windows and clap and cheer for like this moment in time. On his actual, like the moment that he was born. Hopefully it's like daylight and not midnight. What do you think?
Yes, but what if no one's home in his neighborhood?
We can get like a Zoom call, but like a giant projector. Maybe we can like procast it on the projector screen in front of his house. Maybe we could do something like that.
Yeah, but what if your extension cord doesn't go long enough to reach the outside of his house?
Okay, and scene. All right. So how many ideas did we have generated there? Okay, let's see. A parade, a neighborhood shout out, a Zoom, a projection. Okay, all right. So let's try that again. And this next time around, all of us are going to start every sentence with yes and or what if. So yes and or what if. Okay, I'll kick us off and everyone else should feel free to join us. So for Christopher's birthday, I think we could rent the Circle Line and just like go on a cruise around New York City. And yeah.
Yes, and what if we got like a live band to play on the cruise?
Yes, and what if you flew him to Dubai?
Oh my gosh, we could all have a party at the top of the Burj Khalifa. And what if we went on dune buggy rides. Those dune buggy rides in Dubai are so much fun.
And what if we just make this a yearly thing for them?
I think that's a great idea. And I would love to see hot air balloons. This could be like a really good socially distant thing. Like everybody's in their own hot air balloon.
And we can get customized masks for everyone.
Right. And maybe the military can do a parade, you know, for his birthday.
I love that idea. And maybe that mask could have like that fist on it that our friend Malcolm.
True.
All right. And scene. So students, what did you notice about the first yes but session and the second yes and session.
Okay, if I can go first, I kind of noticed that for the yes and sessions, right, the ideas were building off one another, right? So somebody says one thing, another person gives more insights into why we should do it or how we can even do it better. But for the yes but session, the ideas were kind of far off contrasting. Someone else was trying to give an opposite idea, if you kind of understand what I'm saying.
Yeah. Yes, but the blanket on every idea, and it just like truncated the flow, and then there had to be like the sharp contrast with another idea. So you're absolutely right. Yes, and people built on one another's ideas. And what did you all observe about the number of ideas that we generated in the first session versus the second?
So there was more ideas in the second session than in the first.
That's right. And some of them were fantastical ideas, true. But even the fantastical ideas led to like some interesting ideas that could actually be feasible. And that's what we would like you to keep in mind. So I'm going to share my screen again. And so a key facet of ideation is for you to build on one another's ideas. So don't go with yes, but think yes and. Borrowed from the world of improvisation, yes and allows you to build on a person's idea. What if is another useful tool when ideating, because perhaps it's a different idea altogether and takes you in a different path, that's okay. What if, and then you start with a new idea. But the whole goal here is to generate as many ideas as possible. You're going for quantity, not necessarily quality. You can look back later and pick for feasibility, pick for if we had unlimited budget, we could do this thing. And you can pick based on different criteria. But you never know what kernel of an idea is just amazing and really fuels some breakthrough ideas. Okay, so list as many ideas as possible. Remember, take really good notes with you and your partner. And so when you go back into your teams, you're gonna first pinpoint a specific opportunity, a problem during the journey that your mentor shared with you. And then you're gonna generate lots of ideas, different ideas for how your mentor could have been exposed to emotional intelligence a lot sooner and a lot more efficiently than they were in real life. Okay, so I'm going to escape here. I'm going to talk through and mentors. I'm going to place you in those rooms as well. Ramsey, I know you have a hard stop and you will leave in a moment, but I'm going to open all the rooms, and this way you have just some more people than just two. To help you with your ideation session. And this set part will be 6 minutes. See you soon. All right, welcome back. How was that? Energizing? Did you, I see some smiles.
Ran out of time.
It's a good sign.
All right. Okay, so we are going to continue moving steadily through this and keeping up pace. I'm going to share my screen again. And so next, we are going to pick one idea to prototype. Again, this is focusing and flaring. And every time we focus, we could spend a lot of time figuring out what to focus on. We could use many criteria to figure out, well, how much is this gonna cost and how feasible is this? And do we have talent on our team to execute this idea? we could do all of that in real life, but for the purposes of this challenge, we're going to have you pick the idea that rocks your world, okay? Just rocks your world. If this thing existed, then it would be game-changing for young people all across the globe to understand and become aware of emotional intelligence. And what I'd like you to do is to create a very simple prototype. Now, this is hard. We're in a Zoom environment. How do you possibly create a prototype in a Zoom environment? We could have used Google Docs. We could have used some kind of software like that. We also just didn't want to muck up the works with technology problems. So we're going to ask you to sketch out your idea. This idea could be a scene. Perhaps it's with a professor or with a team. Maybe it's a public service announcement. Perhaps it's a YouTube link. You're going to sketch out this scene in, it could be like four different post-it notes or four different 8.5 by 11 pieces of paper. Just sketch out your scene. So when I put you back in your rooms, you're going to pick a specific idea and then you're going to just sketch it out. Don't worry that you do know how to draw or you don't know how to draw. This is not about drawing. This is just rudimentary sketching to get across your idea, to get feedback from your mentor and to get feedback from one another. Okay, so I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. I'm going to send you back into breakout rooms and I'm actually gonna send you back without your mentors so that you can, so that they're not part of this creating part with you, okay? The sketching part with you. And I'm going to move Christopher to room 4. I'm gonna move Yomi to room 4. And I'm going to keep our real industry colleagues with you to help. And I'm gonna give you 6 minutes, okay? Thumbs up? All right, see you soon. Said the host muted everyone. Did I really mute?
I know.
I didn't do it conscientiously. I don't know how that happened. Well, welcome back, everyone. Good to see you again. How did that go? Yeah, all right. I'm seeing smiles. Excellent. Okay. Let me share my screen. And we're almost at the home stretch here. So let's see what we've got. All right. You've picked one idea to prototype. And now it's time to test your idea. And this is really the important part. You're gonna test your idea to learn more about the problem. Yes, you're gonna get feedback about this idea, whether it's utility or how it can be adapted. And you might be like, oh, they don't like my idea. Go back to the drawing board to a new idea. But it almost doesn't matter what you're testing, what that idea is. You're gonna learn more about the problem. And besides, you had a long list of ideas that you could have picked from to begin with, right? And this process is so fast that you could quickly imagine what any of these ideas look like. So you are going to test your idea next. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And we're in such a small environment. I don't know if it makes sense for us to divide and present. So I'm going to have each, like, decide who on your team is going to hold up. Maybe this is just a matter of who has the sheet that you're holding up. Maybe one person holds up the sheet and the other person speaks, or you decide as a team. I'm going to call on you just in the efficiency of time. And I'm going to call on Yannick and Grace first. So unmute yourself and give us like a 30-second sort of presentation of this idea.
I can show my paper if you want. Mm-hmm. So can you see that? Is it flipped? Can you read it?
A little bit.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to read, but let's see, I could pin your video and that makes you bigger, but also more importantly, yeah, that's a little bit better. More importantly, sort of bring it to life with your words.
Yeah, so we were thinking of doing like short 3 minutes, 3 to 5 minute videos for elementary school students. And they would just, each video would, it would be like a video series. So the first video might be what is emotional intelligence? And, you know, second one could be how to manage your emotions. So they would be in a like a cartoon format. And we were thinking of doing a video twice a week. And throughout the, it would be, well, different videos would have a different concept, but the first video we were thinking, you know, I don't remember that cartoon, but you would open the book and the story would come alive, something like that. And we were thinking throughout the video, like with Dora, I guess I'm stealing ideas, but like with Dora, they ask questions.
Yeah.
They would ask questions to the kids and they could answer. It wouldn't be interactive, but you know, something like Dora style, but that's what we came up with so far.
All right, team. I have to say, okay, who was your person that you pitched this to?
We didn't get to pitch it, but.
No, sorry, let me rephrase that. Were you with Ramsey?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So you'll have a chance to, in the future, I think on Friday, to present this to him. I love this idea. I can't wait to see the PBS special or the thing that gets shown during Backyardigans and Dora series. You know, I can just totally picture little public service announcements.
Yes.
It doesn't have to be a whole series. I love this idea. And I can't wait for the two of you to build it out just a little bit further. This is a low resolution prototype, right?
Okay.
I can picture even like comic book strip style, or maybe even just in a Google slide, like different photos, and just hack what that screen could look like, or maybe put cartoon bubbles on characters that you know from years gone past. But I can't wait to see your next iteration of this. This is lovely. Anyone else? Any quick comments for the student team?
Yeah, I want to say I love that idea as well. Just the cadence, it seems like it was well thought of. I can't believe you guys came up with that in 6 minutes. So kudos to you guys. The cadence of every twice a week, 3 minutes, because that's short. The attention span is perfect. And I can't wait to see what you guys build on. So good work.
Thank you.
Also, just to piggyback, love the overall construct of making it something that's fun and approachable, meeting kids where they are, and introducing it at an earlier stage in development is really, really smart. And also love the push that it's not just a passive thing, but you're trying to think about how to make it more interactive and participatory. Love that push. Really, really cool.
Awesome. Thank you, team. We're going to move next to Aniti and Jessica. And I'm hoping that I pronounced your name correctly. Can you correct me?
You did quite right. Yeah, Aniti is fine.
Excellent. Okay, great. So who will I put the spotlight on and who will be speaking?
Okay, I think I can speak while Jessica just has a quick, she can share. She did some Google Doc kind of
mock-up. Great.
Yeah. It's not really great, so not to get your okay. hooks up. Yeah.
Okay, Jessica, do you want to share your screen while Aniti talks? Great, thank you.
Okay, so just a quick context so that our idea kind of makes sense. We were working with Christopher. He shared his career journey with us. And one pinpoint we established was when he was about to be a parent. He was working at the time. He was a freelancer. And because of the need for stability, he had to leave his freelance role and take on more stable employment. And so the challenge for us would have been, how can we design a solution such that if, for instance, his freelance job was his passion, he wouldn't have to leave his freelance job to take on more stable employment just because he was getting a child. So could we create sort of a win-win situation for Christopher? And that's kind of the problem statement, right? So our idea really was around education and how we can build a support group, a professional support group, where Chris could meet with past people in the past who've been in situations where he's currently been, right? And they would provide the support, the added support that he would need. But just because education is not in terms of education and, oh, somebody else had been in this shoe, you will still have bills to pay. Chris will still have bills to pay. He will still have to pay his mortgage. So the banks will not hear that, oh, Chris is in an educational support group, so he's not gonna be paying his mortgage. So the idea was around the government providing set stability, right, for Chris, in the sense that they could cater some of these government contracts that they award to large corporations could be handed off to these similar support groups, right, all across the country, that Chris and other people who are in the support group could bid for and still gain that stability while they get do their freelance role on the side and kind of welcomes his child. So that was just the whole idea we're thinking about for now.
Well, team, congratulations. I really love the reframe that you undertook. What you did was you dove in and looked at a specific use case of a person, a professional, who has a thriving freelance business, but the uncertainty of that, you could really remove the risk by creating communities and providing some government backing, kind of like an SBA loan. In a sense, it's guaranteed, you'll have a safety net here. Continue with this work and we will be your backup. That's pretty great. And this professional support group could provide the emotional intelligence support needed for those freelancers to strengthen their offering or strengthen their resolve that they could weather the storm, exactly, whatever storm came their way. I think there's something there. I think especially as we're increasing the knowledge economy and people need to reframe their skills quickly, and we're going into a new administration, and communities of practice are so helpful as support groups that this idea has some legs. So I can't wait to see how you advance this prototype and flesh it out a little bit more. And imagine, maybe you have that brochure that a Chris would have received, that even before he was even thinking about having kids, right? That says, have a stable grounding as a freelance person. And what does that brochure offer? And what does this community do? And what is the government so I think it's simply a flyer that might show what membership in such a community could provide to a person like Chris to maintain his freelance practice.
Okay.
I can't wait to see what you and Jessica do. Nice work, team. And last but not least, we have the final team. Let's see, Maria and Yara. Okay, I'm gonna pin your video so we can get a little closer. Oh, yeah, we can see that. Let me take the pin off of Grace. Okay, great.
Okay, so our idea was to create an interview simulator so people could go in, start, and there would be like a person, but not a real one, asking them questions, and it would be recorded, and they could rewatch how they did at the end. And after that, it would be published like on YouTube, not on YouTube. And there would be a comment section where volunteer recruiters could give their feedback and other people could tell them what to do, what not to do. And that would train people on how to react and how to connect with themselves more.
Okay, this is genius. I love this idea. And a YouTube channel is so easy to prototype that you could actually, even just the two of you, do some mock interviews in a sense, and like, or maybe you, oh, I'm gonna share with you a video. I'm gonna try to find a way to get you this video. It's of a team at IDEO simulating an Elmo mobile app. And so you could essentially, without doing any coding, create this simulator. And by Friday, have something that shows generally what this thing could be. There's so many wonderful AI tools that you could even, you know, have, you could totally build this out. Maybe not you, but you could have this built out easily. So regardless of whether it's like videos in a YouTube playlist or like a simulator that any one of us, right? Instead of coming to this event, you go to this website, you answer certain ideas, and maybe it tells you how you should redirect or how you came across or what things were high on the emotional intelligence list and what things might have like cast a little bit of a shadow, and basically give you some real-time feedback. That would be pretty interesting too. So first of all, nice work. Give it up for this last team, everyone. Nicely done. I want you to all pause for a minute. We were all tasked with thinking about ways to introduce emotional intelligence to people at different parts of their journey. And look at how we came up with three widely varying ideas, incredibly powerful, different stages of life, different medium. And if we had another, if we did this as a design sprint over 8 hours or a week, imagine the range of ideas and how much further we could have taken any one of these ideas. And this is the kind of skill set design thinking that gives great creative confidence, right? Creativity is a muscle. We need to exercise it. And many people think, I'm not creative, but actually we need to continue to exercise this muscle in order to be more creative. So we're almost at time, and I'm going to share my screen to just give you a few last minute instructions for the next steps. All right. So I am not going to take you into how design thinking and this flaring and focus process helps you get things done. I'm not going to tell you how valuable it is to stay in the problem space before you get into a solution space and how many different frameworks there are. I am going to tell you that for this week, your challenge is to work with your teammate and flesh out your idea further. We're not looking for the final, like a fully baked solution. We're looking for more sketches, more colorful prototypes that could be in a Google slide or images. You could even build out a Google, like a fake YouTube channel. There's the more you flesh it out, the better it is. You're going to get some great feedback on Friday when you have mentors joining and reviewing these prototypes. We'd like you to submit your prototype by Thursday at this link. Tara will email you all the instructions right after this meeting. And we want to remind you that this is a 10-week series. Each session is designed to hone your emotional intelligence and strengthen your design mindset. And there's no better way to being in a learning stance rather than a knowing
it's
stance.
It's 5 o'clock.
Really being in a learning mindset than getting mentor feedback. So every week you're getting mentor feedback on Fridays, 3 p.m. Eastern, noon Pacific. And so we'd really want to make sure that you come to this event, and we'd like your feedback. And Tara, I noticed that the feedback link is not here, but will you please drop it in the chat window? So Tara will drop a bit.ly link in the chat window so that you can share with us your feedback about the session. We really mean it. Feedback is a gift. Without your feedback, we would not get better, and we would not be able to be successful in serving students who need access to careers and who need a better start, which is our theory is that we can give you a better start into your careers. So yes, I see that Tara has dropped a link in the chat window. No link, Tara? You're on mute.
I put it in the chat window.
Oh, okay, that's the submission link. And so the survey link, which is for everyone, the students and the mentors,
Oh, sorry, keep going the wrong way.
complete this. This is the submissions link.
Yep, one sec.
Okay. Make it. Thank you. So let me write that out so that it's an easy to click link. No.
Oh, sorry. It just keeps copying the wrong one. I'm not good at that.
That's okay. I will get it.
Thanks.
Okay. I think this will do it. Okay. Colleagues, students, and mentors, if you wouldn't mind clicking on that link and please, 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 please completing this survey, we would greatly appreciate it. We want to strengthen this program. Thank you. Thank you for staying 2 minutes late. Oh.
Yeah, it says
okay.
Something more, something's wrong here.
Here, let me try.
Maybe it's the www.
It's 2021, not 2020.
My fault. I'm so sorry.
No worries.
Make it 2021 survey. How does that work? Thank you. All right, team. Thank you so much. Great to have you all here. Hope this was as valuable for you as it was for us. Look forward to your feedback and see you on Friday.
Thanks, everybody. Take care.
Thank you, everyone.
Take care, everyone.
Thank you.